Greetings, everyone. I'm Aaron Hansen, and on behalf of everyone here at OTTX, I'm delighted to welcome you to episode 9 of OTTX videocast, The Buzz. If you're interested in getting in on the insider's take of what's shaking in the OTT streaming world, you are in the right place. We have some extraordinary accomplished leaders from our industry to preside over the world of streaming and talk to us about what they think is important and in our world today. Presiding over today is a group of OTT rabble rousers. We're excited once again to welcome industry prognosticator and pontificator, Colin Dixon, the founder and chief analyst at InScreen Media. Before we turn things over to this episode's crew of Buzzketeers, I want to make sure to mention that you can find and subscribe to all episodes of The Buzz via podcast on Spotify. Just search out for OTTX and be sure to follow us so you can receive all future episodes as well. We'll drop the Spotify link in the podcast in the chat just a second, so you'll be able to get there easily. With that, I'm thrilled to welcome this episode's moderator and a great partner to OTTX, Colin Dixon of InScreen Media.
Thank you very much, Eric. I'm delighted to be here. Happy Valentine's Day to you. Happy Valentine's Day to everybody that's listening. I can't promise you a big wet kiss and a hug on Valentine's Day, but I can promise you some sweet nuggets of OTT knowledge about the latest news from our industry from a really great panel of experts. So, experts, please join us. We have Matthew Singerman. He is president of KFA Consulting. Welcome, Matthew.
Thank you.
And Matthew, just take a moment. Tell us about KFA Consulting. Tell us what you do.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Real quick, I help brands or companies or entrepreneurs start fast channels. A lot of emphasis on distributing fast channels or acquiring content, and just 360 strategy and everything you can do around fast, making a fast channel and maintaining it and making it successful as possible.
So your life is really quite quiet at the moment.
Nothing to do.
Nothing to do.
Just panel after panel.
We also have Michelle Edelman, who's head of growth of Premier Digital. Michelle, tell us what you do.
So I'm sure most of you know Premier Digital is a media services company. We specialize in supply chain. I am the head of growth, sales and marketing, trying to get your business and keeping the company going in the right direction.
Very good. Josh Pine is chief revenue officer of Excelate. Josh.
Hello, everybody. Excelate is a AI tech company based in the Silicon Valley area, comprised of tech experts that came out of Google and Apple. We created our own machine translation AI technology to specifically based and trained on media and entertainment that are our own engines, trained on 20 to 30 years of golden data out of the biggest LSPs in the industry. We're here to help support the localization, the creation of AI creation of subtitles and then translation in simultaneously into up to 70 languages at the same time, helping companies like Michelle's and other major and mid-sized LSPs, language service providers, to help streamline the process of taking content globally.
Very good. And I'm very glad to have you because it's a very complicated world, AI, at the moment. And maybe you can help us unravel some of it today.
I would love to do that.
Bill Sondheim is president and chief executive officer of Greenfield Media. Bill, introduce yourself.
I am running a consulting firm that really does three different things. First, I work for several distribution entities that need strategic advice on how to release and best exploit their assets, including companies like Giant Pictures, Neon Pictures, and Bleecker Street. Additionally, I executive produce, or I was executive producing several films a year. Last year, the strike threw me off quite a bit.
So hopefully
that returns this year. And in that instance, I'm doing everything from budgeting to cast development to then creating the pitch materials. I'm not a physical producer. I kind of do the business setup of productions, get them funded, get them cast, and then turn it over to people that are in the creative industry to actually do the filming, editing, and post work. And then I also do producer rep work for existing producers there, where I'm not so engaged in the early formation of the product, but the product is done. Now they need it to be pitched to various platforms, and I help them in that as well.
Well, I sure hope you've been busy, because we want more stuff to watch.
This is going to be an interesting year to help pick up the slack from what happened with the strike last year. Absolutely.
Very good. And last but definitely not least, we have Chris Yates, who's Chief Commercial Officer of Mansa. Chris, why don't you introduce yourself, what you do?
Thanks, Colin. Thanks, guys. Great to be here. So Chief Commercial Officer at Mansa. Mansa is a free streaming service for global Black culture, founded by some amazing filmmakers and actors from the industry. I oversee content programming, monetization, and distribution for the business.
So maybe, Chris, that's a great place to start. Let's talk free. Let's talk fast. This week, Fox announced its results. Actually, I think it was just at the end of last week, Fox announced its results. And in there, it showed some pretty spectacular growth for Tubi. They said 62% increase in viewing time, although they declined to say exactly how much people were watching, although I've got a rough idea, along with a 17% spike in advertising revenue for the fiscal quarter that ended last year. And that wasn't enough to make up for their losses in traditional TV, but it did definitely offset quite a lot. I cranked some other numbers that they gave. They said 78 million average monthly users, 2.5 billion streaming hours. When you crank all those numbers, you get about 20 minutes a day, I think, is what that worked out to for each of those 78 million average users, which is pretty decent, right? So my question to you, Tubi seems to have gotten the fast formula right. Would you agree?
Would I agree? You know, that's a good question. I don't know if anyone could say they've got it right just yet. Challenge that people like Tubi have, and they're a phenomenal business, by the way, is the behavior that their customers have is an on-demand one. They're growing their fast business, but at the same time, you know, their customers come to them for on-demand first. And I think migrating people from one behavior to another is tricky. We see the same thing in the reverse with folk like Pluto. You know, I think Tubi's obviously got a massive install base to work with, but I don't know if they will even say that they've gotten fast right just yet.
Yeah. Matthew, what do you think? Are they?
Well, look, I think they're doing some things right. I mean, they've actually implemented AI in the search, so I think probably that's helped people, and that's something new and something I'm sure others will get into, making a difference. And they have a huge library. I mean, they have over 60,000 titles going, and I think their extensive library is thing that people want quality content. And you know, I think that Chris was right that they're still working on the fast and the VOD. They go there first, but they're optimizing that and they're catching up on fast. Look, they have over 300 channels now, and they're focused on it. So I think they're doing a lot of things right, and that's what's helping them.
Very good. So, Michelle, what do you think? Is Tubi a great opportunity for content providers? Should they be running to Tubi with their content?
Yeah, I think Tubi has done a really good job of targeting their audience. They sort of, you know, put a lot of stuff out there, and then they focus, you know, right in on that specific audience and what we see is that the people that are looking for content are coming back and saying, we need the following. They're not just like, give us everything. They're saying, we need specifics because we know who our audience is right now, or a good subset of our audience and who's watching. So they're being specific and very conscientious about what they're asking for, which I think is important. Like, know your audience, go after it. Don't know your audience and start looking for other things. Like really target, nurture, get them going, and then things will kind of grow from there. And I respect them for that.
Yeah, Colin, so, if I could just add from the from the producer's perspective, Tubi has been probably one of the most important and dynamic growth opportunities over the last year to 2 years for the independent producer. They have been extremely open-minded. If you have the right kind of targeted demographic content, like Michelle was just pointing out correctly, you can really get good support from them. And they're paying pretty good money. And I find that a lot of independent producers are finding Tubi one of the easier doors to knock on and get attention at. And I think that's played well for them up to this point. Now, I do think that the competition and the level of content is changing in our industry in the AVOD space. And the need to have that higher level of content is creeping in as the studios start to have AVOD offerings as well. But Tubi seems to be wanting to adjust to that as well, as they're looking for higher quality productions as well. So they've surfed this first part of the wave, I think, quite effectively.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, I've been quite impressed at how well Fox has managed them as well. I was a little bit nervous when they purchased Tubi, but they seem to have done an outstanding job in managing. I have a question about the originals. Tubi has done some originals. They're usually very targeted for very, very specific demographics that they're really aiming for. I was wondering, Fast has grown dramatically. And by the way, when I say Fast, I'm talking about free ad-supported streaming TV, and I'm lumping in everything that's free into that, not just the Fast channels. So, I was wondering, they're generating a lot of revenue now, Pluto TV over $1 billion. So do we think we're going to see a situation where we're going to start to see some really big budget originals produced by a strictly Fast vendor? What do we think?
I'll jump in. I think that's already happening to some extent. Yeah, I think some of them have really jumped into that. Some are jumping in a big way. You know, Roku was jumping in a big way. Others have, I won't say who, jumped in and jumped out, and others are now starting, kind of taking baby steps to it. So I think you are going to see it, but I think some will shun it and say, we don't want to go that route, it's risky, and others will double down on it. It's going to be all over the map for the platforms, is my POV.
I think what's going to happen is there, you know, we've got all these amazing franchises, and I think that it's a great place for, you know, third, fourth, fifth versions of certain franchises that have been out there, just because the awareness level is so great. So we're probably going to see some, you know, bigger franchises starting in those areas, which would be exciting for people.
Yeah.
I always tend to wonder, like, what is big budget in a Fast world? You know, it's, the economics are tricky, right? You know, the reason that windowing exists, and the reason that, you know, people, you know, customers might hate that it starts in a theater, or it used to at least, you know, and then takes forever to get to Fast, is frankly because it's maximizing, you know, at an ARPU level, at a lifetime value level, skipping all the way straight to Fast. Tubi's doing a great job of their originals. I think it's definitely doable. We think about it a lot at Mansa. We think more about episodic than we do about features. Having said that, scripted's difficult. Just from an economic standpoint. Having said that, you know, they're doing it. They're doing it at a what would you say? Probably a low single digit budget level.
But there were some big tries, because like Freevee did Leverage, which was a big show and put a lot of money into that. Yeah, and they're doing season two, but sharing it with Amazon, I think, Prime this time.
I mean, from my experience, I'm seeing in the movies, I'm much more movie centric in what I do. And with Tubi, you know, I was regularly seeing them in the $250,000 range doing license deals for films. And now I hear them talking, and I'm engaged in different dialogues with them to fund productions that are 750 to a million too. So they're not huge to the point Chris is making. They're not huge swings in the bat, but they're not inconsequential either. And when you get to 1 million to 1.2 million, you have real names in that. You have an original program, maybe like Michelle pointed out, based on a franchise brand. So it has some pre-existing momentum. And that's a formula that I think can be quite successful in a direct to Tubi approach. Now, you know, a $10 million film, you're never going to figure the economics out if you're only going through an AVOD windowing. So that's what Chris is pointing out. But with the right size and the right genre, there's a lot of ifs here, right size, right genre, right timing, I think it is becoming more viable for them.
Yeah.
You know, here's something else. The audience on Tubi is unique. It's younger. So we don't necessarily, and they, you know, their likes are, you know, very YouTube based. So they're used to watching things that might not be of the highest, you know, the highest production numbers. And I think they watch everything from lower to the big blockbusters for sure. But it's definitely an audience that can sustain that genre, that generation, the YouTube folks. So
I'll add one last thing, which is I work for one of my clients is the company that owns America's Funniest Home Videos, and we're actually meeting with a major platform tomorrow about doing some originals for them. So it's out there.
It's natural in a way.
Awesome.
That would be a great project.
Josh, I wanted to bring you into the conversation. One of the things, one of the biggest opportunities, I think, for US-based fast like Tubi is international. There's still a lot of markets where fast is still very nascent, still in a very early stage, much earlier than here. Pluto's enjoyed a lot of success, for example, in the UK and in Germany. So I think there's lots of opportunities to shift services over there. But there are challenges doing that, right?
Well, there's major challenges in it, in that, in the old days of SVOD, when you had a license fee for a license period, and let's say that license fee was, you know, $5 million for a territory, you could very easily figure out, okay, that territory, I'll spend, you know, $20,000, $30,000, $50,000 for a sub and dub package, and then you know what your ROI is going to be right off the bat. When you're going into some of these territories, especially South America, where you have low CPM rates, and you're getting paid in all these territories in most cases on rev share, and that money doesn't come in for 90 days or 120 days. How do you go spend $15,000, $20,000 taking a chance on localizing the content for that territory if you're strictly distributed into the fast world? So you've got to really turn, you got to do two things. One, there's a lot of competition of content going all over the place. In feeding this massive mouth called FAST that's exploding and expanding all over the world. And you've got to do it at a very economical way. And that's where we bring AI into the picture to be able to economically and efficiently in quick turnaround manners be able to help content owners through LSPs or through very inexpensive packages for certain types of FAST content. To be localized, whether it's subtitled, strictly subtitled and translated, or subtitled, translated and dubbed into synthetic dubbing for certain regions where that is acceptable. And so, you know, maybe it's not the type of quality of a sub dub package that you would see for we're talking about production budgets, you know, a $50, $100 million production budget movie when everything has to be 100% perfect, but stuff that people are watching that's of special interest or lower budget stuff where, you know, if something is 90, 95% correct in the translation, it's better than what you see in broadcast subtitles that are being done by stenographers, right? So the quality is still very high up there. And that AI allows you to expand it to some of those territories where you might not have gone before because localization would have been a barrier to entry.
I think it's a huge thing. It's a huge door opener for a lot of independent, smaller budgeted films that, just like Josh just said, have never had an opportunity to be released overseas because of the cost of converting, in particular dub territories, but also subtitling. Yeah. And I think this is going to open up a floodgate of revenue opportunities, low-level, for low-level films in particular, in my opinion,
that's okay.
Will be the and most also- opportune.
And it also allows the content owners to control the rights and the ownership of the IP of the localized content. And in previous years, you would find that when you licensed your content to other territories, the licensee would go ahead and localize it. They would cover those costs. They did it for a reason, because once that license period is up, then they held your localization that they paid for as hostage and tried to sell it back to you at five times what, you know, they paid for it. And then sometimes you don't have a choice. You have to pay whatever they're holding it hostage for if you don't renegotiate your license with them. So it gives the content owners a lot more flexibility to be able to own their own localized product on a global basis, or at least wherever they have the rights to those territories.
Chris, can you talk a little bit about the strategy that you're employing with your content in Fast Channels? Are you looking internationally? How do you decide which platforms you want to be on? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so Mansa is fundamentally two things. One, it's an app that we've developed in-house. We have a phenomenal development team that created, built, and operates the hardware itself, at least the Mansa app. And when you think about for us today, we're US only, but we are thinking deeply about international. And we think about what where we want to go there. Obviously, you're looking at large install bases of OSs. So that's your Samsung, LG, Roku, Fire TV, Vizio, of course. And Android TV. We built our app. It's actually on all of those devices bar Samsung and LG, but it will be in the next, knock on wood, the next 60 to 90 days. And when we think about international, it's actually, it actually is helpful for us to think about Samsung being a, global powerhouse, because we don't have to rebuild the app. We don't have to make it in another OS. That's super helpful. We also have an owned and operated fast channel, a linear channel called Mansa Mix. And for us, again, this is one of those really helpful things. The quote unquote standardization and the large device manufacturers actually being in multiple countries, it can be challenging, because it can obviously, give them leverage and it can make it difficult to negotiate. But it actually is, ultimately it's helpful to the extent that you can create, multiple points of distribution with one deal. So we think about that a lot. For us, US is where we're at now. We'll look to go into Europe and probably Africa in the next couple of quarters. And we'll be leaning on those relationships, those device manufacturers there.
Yeah. You bring up something very interesting, and you mentioned the platforms. There's sort of two levels here, right? For a content provider, it's getting on the fast service in the first place. And then, of course, all the standards and whatnot are different on those fast services. But for the fast services, it's getting on all those OSs. Yeah. And that's not getting any easier either. I tracked this pretty closely. And guess what? We had another one show up. I've forgotten its name right now. Titan OS in Europe. Pretty challenging space, right, Michelle?
Yeah, I mean, yesterday when we were talking, it was about the channels and talking about the channels. And then we kind of drew it back and said, well, let's talk about the platforms, because you have no channel if you have no platform. And, it was smart. I remember, what was it? It was about 2 years ago when FAST started to, the word started coming about, and all the platforms were just out there saying, come on. And now they're being select. They can be select. They should be select. Until we get to a place where, I guess, what I think is that AI is going to help you basically pull out, quote, your channel within the plethora of channels. So I think it's going to look like things will be fed to you. It's almost the same way, I've got my channel through Apple Music. Like, how do they know that's what's going to happen with content? I truly believe.
But doesn't it almost, doesn't it almost feel like 2017, 2018 all over again? At that time, I was head of third-party digital distribution for Sony Pictures and the aggregated labels, and then Alliance Entertainment, as some of you guys here on the panel know. And we couldn't get our content into the big SVOD providers anymore, even though Sony's first-tier product could go into Hulu and Amazon and and Netflix, right?
But you were getting onto the platform.
That's when we started taking the third-party content into Tubi and into Pluto and into Redbox and all that, right? And that actually was the forefront of what became FAST, right? We had to pivot the independent content into other areas. It's like putting a ton of content through a funnel or through a hose. It's going to leak out somewhere because people still love watching independent content. It leads the way to whatever those next genres are going to be. And I think we're finding now in the FAST world that when the studios invade with their catalog, with the catalogs and new content and other stuff and taking up so much of this bandwidth, where does that independent content go? And does the AI, and I think the AI does allow better ways to get it to the consumer who wants to watch it, because it's going to go somewhere. It's going to go somewhere and people are going to figure out how and where to watch it. That's why channels like TikTok and other outlets and YouTube have become so popular for independent content. And we'll figure out ways to channel that and get it into the consumer's hands.
I also think we're going to see a platform consolidation.
Yes,
we haven't, no doubt. We're just starting to see one with SVOD. I mean, mm-hmm. we know it because we're in the business and we've been hearing, is Paramount going away? What's going to happen with Peacock? All of these different things. There's two or three survivors. All that's been just directed toward the SVOD because that was the initial focus of our industry. The reality is that the second tier, which Josh has just talked about, this AVOD, has also oversaturated and overexpanded. We don't need anywhere near the number of channels that we have.
Right.
And yes, there's still going to be good channels, like Matthew just mentioned, a well-branded idea that he's working with one of his clients. So we're going to lose some of the crappier channels. I almost swore. Some of the crappier channels at the bottom of the spectrum. And I'm already hearing it. I'm already hearing from platforms like Roku, hey, this channel isn't performing that you have as a FAST channel. If you can't drive advertising and get your viewership up, we're going to cut it out. I am sure that is going to be something that we see toward the tail end of 24, well into 25.
Oh, yeah.
There's too many FAST channels, in my opinion, based on the amount of consumers.
Look, I always think, I would add to Bill, I agree with you, but I always think, look, I think it's a good thing the platforms are low-performing channels go off. That's the way of life.
Right.
But I think also there's always going to be opportunity for new channels to come
along. If it's strong.
If you have a big brand name, if you fill a white space that no one's doing, or you have an amazing kind of unique value add.
Well,
to the
one
platform.
Of the things that we've seen, and that's a good
Agreed.
Point.
Agreed.
One of the things that we've seen and we've helped build our company around is localization traditionally has just been 80% of localization has over the inception has been English to other languages, right? If there's any good, if you will, if you could say that oxymoron that came out of COVID when we were all home watching everything, is that we've realized, oh, wow, there's great content that's coming out of Korea, that's coming, telenovelas that are coming out of Turkey that the Latin American market loves. And now we've had to completely change how the models work for localization and go from other languages into English. We're seeing more foreign content coming in and being consumed
Absolutely.
In the U.S. than we ever have before. When I was growing up, if you wanted to see a foreign film, you went to your little local foreign cinema on a Friday or Saturday night, and at best it was half full, and then you were considered, kind of high society that you went and did that, right? But now we're consuming everything coming in from other territories, and there's a lot of really good content outside of the U.S. that's coming in, and that's changing how we're viewing and what's going on these FAST channels as well.
Yeah,
I completely agree.
It's going to come down to the search factor. I mean, we're talking about channels because they call them FAST channels, but the reality is that people want, do they want to watch a channel? No, they want to watch something. They want to watch a show,
okay.
They want to watch a movie. They've got, very specific, demographic, documentary genres, all these things. And it's sort of needle in the haystack. I feel like the content is going to drive, like we as the people in the business have to program by channel because that's what we have. And the way to get on is to have the mass. But the truth is you're going to have one asset in there that's going to drive everything. And it's how do we get to this search AI component where it just falls into your lap. That's really what it is. It's like, I want the perfect show to fall into my lap that I want to watch. And I can sit down every night and be like, oh yeah, that's for me. I don't need to go digging and be the person who's like, spent a half hour looking for something versus spending that half hour enjoying what I can see.
Amen to that. I totally agree. I think we have a tool that was born to manage 20 channels back in cables, in the cable era, and we're now employing it to manage hundreds.
2,000.
And I don't see any reason why there shouldn't be 2,000 if a channel has an audience. It's just a question of finding it. But look, we have, I think we should move on to our next topic. Although I would say, I think we could easily have gone the whole hour on this topic because we did everything that I think would have been interesting too. So we had a very popular Super Bowl last weekend, 123.4 million viewers on CBS, although they declined to tell us how many people watched on Paramount Plus. But don't worry, I'm going to estimate that later this week and have that up on my site, Endscreen Media, next week. But interestingly enough, we had the announcement by Disney, Fox, and Warner that they're doing their sports JV. And when that sports JV arrives, which I gather will be later this year, you will not be able to see the Super Bowl or any NFL on it. You won't be able to see any of the sports that are owned by NBC or indeed by CBS. So this bundle has a lot in it, but, and it's, I think the widely touted price is $40 to $45 is what people think it will cost. What do we think about the big sports bundle?
Look, I would say, you know, first of all, I think the Super Bowl will, I think one thing, the Super Bowl will be on it certain years if ABC has it. So I think there are years they have the Super Bowl and years
every
they don't.
Years.
But what's that? Yes, yeah, every 4 years you get the Super Bowl. It's like the Olympics on that channel. It's every 4 years. But look, I think, look, first of all, I think Fox is a big winner because unlike ESPN, they didn't have a streaming service they were getting into, and everybody needs like their own streaming service where they're going to put their sports events. So I think Fox is a huge winner. But I think, look, the one last thing keeping cable TV alive and traditional TV alive is sports, and especially NFL. And now that you're putting something like this together and giving people another choice of somewhere they can just get all the sports they wanted in a streaming position. I mean, the loser, I think, is linear TV, traditional TV again, and the winner is this bundle, and people will get it. I mean, people love sports. It's what they want, and it's a big problem for traditional. It's a huge win for these guys, and assuming they package it right and do it right, it could be a driver of a lot of subscriptions, I think. I by the way, I've worked for the NFL for 8 years, and I worked for Fox for many years, so I kind of get like how important those entities are just from that their side of things.
I take a look at it and more from the macro view and say, I've been saying this for a while, we need to get to a bundling process because the consumer experience is so fragmented now and so costly if you really want to watch a lot of different diverse product that it's going to ultimately build to a turnoff to the consumer. And so, yes, this first bundle is in a way a stimulation of people starting to think and plan into bundling. I think from some sports fans that I've talked to, it's a little bit of a good thing and not great because it doesn't have everything. And this is kind of the ongoing dilemma that the consumer is facing. And I don't want to have to Google every time I have to try to find my sporting team because it's like all over the place. It's constant. Yeah. It's really, I mean, I'm in the industry, so I understand what's going on. What about just a regular consumer? They're like, what the heck? This is improved. So we're going to need to get to a bundled experience. And in my opinion, the SVOD players are going to need to recognize that they don't benefit completely by dominating and owning the direct consumer to a point where it fragments the business, that it might make sense to share some of their back data and allow somebody like an Amazon or a Verizon to bundle multiple services at a discount. And yes, that means that each of these SVOD companies will not have the direct data, though I'm sure they'll get more data if they negotiate, but it'll be such a better ongoing consumer experience that it'll help to sustain our business.
But it has to come down, but it has to eventually spread out to a local level. You're right, it's good for football, but when, you know, here in Los Angeles, if you're a Dodgers or a Lakers fan, you can't watch without having Spectrum or DirecTV. That's it. And I don't care if you cut the cord, that's the only way to watch it.
You know, the question that I ask myself, I actually think it's a really interesting move that they're setting up their own quote-unquote virtual MVPD for sports and not partnering in and not diving in with, you know, some of their existing partners. The thing that
Which,
I think,
by the way, has gotten a lot of blowback today in the Wall Street Journal. The commissioner of the NFL is supposedly fuming that they would have this level of discussion and not talk to the NFL about it, which is, as Matthew knows, the NFL expects that kind of treatment. They are very engaged with their broadcasters. So sorry to interrupt you.
No, not
100%.
They are
not very laid back.
You know, the thing that I think about in this space, and I, you know, we're all in this industry, so I feel like having every streaming service is just a tax on my profession. And I do, and I have streaming services that I'm not going to name them, but I subscribe but don't watch any, I haven't watched them for months, but would never consider cutting it. I think the challenge or the question that I have is, if you have 60% of everything, what are you cutting out to add this new $40 to $50 a month question? Because again, I have YouTube TV. I actually, it's a phenomenal service. It does have most, not everything again, but again, it's like, I don't want YouTube TV and a virtual MVPD for sports.
Right.
And my Netflix, Amazon, you know, the list
and
goes.
And by the way, next. YouTube TV has the NFL package, which is a huge one.
They do, but they don't. But they don't have Lakers stream. And Dodgers. Like my kids have the YouTube TV, and they still password share with me. Don't tell anybody. You know, to go watch the Lakers and Dodgers. I mean, so
you're saving your kids a lot of pain. So don't worry about it.
So let me throw out this. I one of the things, I listened very closely to Disney's earnings call. I always do. Bob Iger always has something interesting to say. And he was asked very specifically about this service and how it plays with ESPN D2C, which is scheduled to launch in August of 2025. Now, all the ESPN channels are here in this service. I mean, all of them.
Yes.
Much. And what he said was that it will be a better experience. There'll be, there'll be betting. I think he said, what else? Maybe some specific programming that isn't available there. Interactivity. Will it be enough? If I'm buying this $45 package and I've got my ESPN channels, am I now going to shell out more for ESPN D2C?
I believe that ESPN D2C is going to go by the wayside if this is successful. I think that that was thought about earlier before they came up with this consolidated approach. And I don't believe that both are viable side by side, in my opinion.
So I do want to share something, because I'm listening and I'm wondering if this was, you know, a panel of middle-aged women, what this would sound like, which I sort of am. Not there completely, but the two words that I want to point out that are the most important. Number one is audience. We have, you know, our audiences are way more fragmented than they were, you know, years ago. And it's economics, because people really care now. And an audience like ours is like, yeah, we paid for cable years ago. We were used to this. We understood this. Now we're breaking it up. It's looking a little strange. You know, I spoke with my 21-year-old nephew last night, who's, you know, at college in Michigan. And I was just talking to him about like how he watches things. Not even close. You know, he will be the ESPN D2C guy paying for it on his perfectly. It's kind of like people are finding ways to see what they want to see depending upon how old they are. That's what's happening. It's the audience. The audience is kind of, and I think that we're doing specific things. And I know for back Disney, and you know, their research is monstrous. They have a huge research division. They're not just going to do something because it sounds good. They're doing something because they're betting a lot on it, and they've got the research to back it. So they're going to go down that route. It's all about the audience, and you know, we're in a huge sea change right now, but And we used to, you know, I remember like following big companies, they would sort of tell us what to do. It's reversed now. It's like the big companies are following the audiences because they've got them there. People are telling them what they want.
Yeah,
they're making decisions upon that.
I had a lot of trouble figuring out who they think this is for. There was a lot of talk about it being for, quote, cord cutters. But I think, Matthew, this isn't for cord cutters. This is to allow people to cut the cord.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, look, I think that's correct, because you need I think for people who are sports fans, the one reason they have cable still is for sports. I mean, look what happened to DirecTV when they lost the NFL ticket. People, they shed millions and millions and millions of viewers. So the more sports translates, goes to streaming, the bigger problem for traditional. And I think, look, I think there's a competition. I mean, the bigger picture of streaming and sports, not just this new service, is all the streamers are after sports rights. They see it as a difference maker. Amazon with Thursday Night Football, YouTube TV with the ticket, MLB packages now going. I mean, it's just a race. I mean, regular TV is going to keep losing and losing out on these sports packages. And as it migrates to streaming, in the big picture, you're going to see a faster and faster dissolution of the traditional TV model.
Yeah, people run after sports. There's no doubt about that. I mean, like, who's, are we talking about DirecTV anymore? The second that, you know, that NFL package kind of
disappeared.
Escaped.
Yeah.
It was unfortunate. That's why people were there.
Chris, you had something?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, how many households in the U.S. have cable today? Still 70, 75 million?
Yeah.
Cable. So, No. It's
oh, well,
it's like 60 something, isn't it?
60 now. It's below 60.
Down to 60.
If you add in the virtual MVPDs, you get to about 78.
Yeah. Okay. Right. So when I think about it, I think, going back to Michelle's point about the audience, I feel like the audience for this is a subset of that 78. What it's not going to do, at least in my opinion, is someone who's never subscribed to cable, someone under the age of, I don't know, 30, they're not going to suddenly start subscribing to this package, this service, if they've never subscribed to any kind of pay television service before. So it's really a subset of that 78 million, some version of that, whatever that, you know, whatever the TAM is, it's probably, you know, some, I don't know what the number is, 5 to 10, it'll max out, you know, kind of number.
Okay, so let's move on to one more topic. Let's see if we can squeeze at least one more in the last 14 minutes here. Another thing that came out of the Disney call is that they're now talking about going after people that are sharing accounts in the same way that Netflix did. Now, listen, this has worked out really well for Netflix. As far as I can tell, very few people are paying for an extra location. What this has done has gotten the people who have the subscriptions to tell the people that are borrowing to get their own account. And got to credit Netflix with the rollout. They created the low price ad supported tier just before. So there was a nice low cost option for people to go to. And it seems to have worked fabulously. Will Disney do as good a job? What do we think? Chris, you're smiling. You obviously have an opinion.
It depends how you define do a good job. Will they drive signups with it? Probably. You know, and so will it increase their profitability? Probably. Do I think, I don't really have a strong opinion on whether or not it's the right or the wrong thing to do, because let's face it, if you're borrowing someone's subscription to a certain point, you expect that you're going to have to pay. So I don't know if it's really that big of a problem to have to do it at a certain point. I feel like they'll probably do a decent job. It probably increase subs, and that'll probably be a good thing for them.
For a while, until the point where the 20 to 35 year olds figure out another way around it.
I mean, I think they already have. And I think that's the audience that's going to be in jeopardy with these moves, because I know my kids already, and I think everyone that has kids in the 20s or 30s already understands how to rotate through, how to go to a service, do a 30-day free trial, watch what you need to, and then
they do that. And like I have the perfect test subjects, right? I have four kids between 20 and 30, and so they've already figured out what they all live out of the house, but they've all figured out what their friends. You buy a family subscription, and you divide that up. They all share the family subscriptions. You get up to five locations within a certain radius of for the YouTube TV at least, and the football package, and they share it. And
I think you're seeing it in taste. I mean, I think, for example, you said, will Disney succeed in this? Personally, I think Disney will be hurt by the 20 to 30 year old, because I think a lot of them are already on that site, but they don't really need to be on it. And the Marvel product that had been their most attractive thing has really tanked recently. So they don't have the same draw. However, from what I'm hearing in my own kitchen marketing, HBO Max right now has a lot of shows that the young people want. What I also hear is Netflix is essential. And if we look at this, at the churn rates that are published, Netflix is in the low single digits, 2 to 3%. Some of these other companies are at 30 and 40% churn rates. That is unsustainable. That means right. that in every year, you have to replace a third of your entire client base. That's really hard to do. So I think certain companies, and another one is Paramount, where everyone I heard, oh yeah, no, I have to go watch, you know, the latest Western. But once I've streamed through that, I don't know, do I need Paramount? And Paramount's been very lumpy because of that. I think this is going to really accentuate the stickiness and lack thereof of some of these SVOD services. And we're going to feel it.
The one thing I understand what you're saying. I think the one thing I would say is, will it at the end of a quarter have a net ad? Will it create net ads? Probably. Other people will say, you know,
yeah,
what?
Yeah, you might be right, because there might be so much sharing going on. You might be right.
It may not be an extra 5 million subs, but will it have a net benefit? The people who are never going to subscribe are never going to subscribe, and you might lose some ad revenue from those guys, but will it have net ads? Probably.
The thing that Netflix seems to have figured out is that balance between bread and butter shows and bigger titles, right? That's what they seem to have figured out. It seems like the other SVOD services are kind of struggling with that.
They had a really good head start, though. We have to remember that. I mean, they were the first to go. So they're in a cadence right now. Everyone else is kind of like trying to catch their cadence. You know, something else to point out. It's like, I remember, you know, years ago, it was like the cable operator and the cable company was like the driver. And it was like, you know, used to watch their stocks and, you know, their net ads and their losses. Now it's like, it's interesting. It's so fragmented, but every company is, you know, has way more tools to work with today. They can, you know, get down to the microeconomics of their business, and they're taking a few risks. I believe Disney is, you know, this is not just a quick decision. They've been looking at this for a long time, and I think they understand kind of what they're going to run into, and, you know, they'll pivot accordingly when the time comes. It really is about today. Like, the only thing that can be affected is cable. That's what's going to happen. And I remember years and years ago when they started offering broadband, I was working for a gentleman at Warner Brothers. He's like, these guys should just be in the broadband business. They shouldn't be in the content business, because the margins are greater and they're going to get everyone. It's not going to be a question of, so Colin, when you were talking about the numbers decreasing, you know, from a pay TV bundle, but how many broadband households do we have through the cable guy?
And Colin, I think from what the other thing they've really figured out, and Bill doing a lot of scripted shows will get this, is like how bring these international shows to the US. I mean, you know, whether it's Fauda or Squid Games or whatever, no one really did that before in some sort of big way. And they've shown that these shows from foreign countries can be huge hits here. And I think the other part of it is, what's interesting is, when Netflix, they figured this part out, when Netflix has a huge hit, they don't want to go for 10 seasons. Their whole thing is to, you know, drive subscribers. So you get a hit show, you keep it on for 3 or 4 seasons, and before the costs get too high and crazy, they cancel it because they figure, we have that viewer. Now let's make a new show with that money to keep that viewer or to bring new viewers in.
Yeah.
you know? So they have a very different kind of model when it comes to originals and how to make them and how long to keep them on.
You've got me thinking now, and I'm thinking the three shows I'm watching on Netflix right now are all foreign. Midnight Diner, Extraordinary Attorney Wu, and Lupin.
There you go.
All foreign.
Yeah.
Great, by the way.
And that never happened in the old studio system.
No,
you never got, I mean, it like Josh was pointing out at one point, you'd be an intellectual if you were going to watch a foreign film in the old days. Now,
right.
It has become very mainstream.
And I think COVID changed our viewing habits, and they changed them for the good, and they changed them forever.
Yeah, it absolutely did. There's no doubt about that. And the things that I remember years ago when documentaries were like, no one wanted a documentary. It was the hardest thing. I was working at Warner and we were doing, you know, acquisitions, trying to bring more content in, and everyone was like, and then all of a sudden there was like this boom, and you know, you can't keep documentaries on the shelf. They're like, that's all people want to see.
Yeah.
So I have a few if you need any.
Shifting. I'm sorry.
I have a few extras if you need any.
We have 6 minutes left. If there's anybody in the audience who would like to pitch an opinion or a question into the Q&A window, do so now. We are going to touch on one more topic, unless I see a question show up there pretty quickly. And that question is about Disney losing 10 million subs from 1 year ago. Disney Plus is down 14 million from 1 year ago.
And their profitability improved.
Profitability certainly did.
Their losses narrowed.
So why do you think that was? Why do you think they were able to do that?
You know, one of the things that's a little dangerous in counting subscriptions is not having the detail behind what are those subscriptions paying. You know, there's the, you know, the average user paying your ARPO. With Disney in particular, they had a lot of very low cost overseas subscriptions. So I'm not sure how profitable some of the subscribers they were getting out of India, for example, were in their overall product mix.
That's a good point.
Yeah, they definitely started calling those out separately. One other thing that Disney was doing was any subscriber to the triple or double play bundle was counted as a subscriber to all of the apps that are part of the bundle. And the way they had the triple pay bundle particularly subscribed, priced, you would have been crazy not to go for it if you wanted any two of those apps. So apps were getting credits for subscribers that weren't users.
Yeah.
So I think that has been an issue for Disney. They really need this paid streaming, paid sharing to work, I think, to reverse this trend, because they're not creating more content, they're creating less. They're removing content from the service. Do you think that they might be interested in doing competitor bundles like Netflix has started to do? Netflix is in a competitor bundle from Verizon Plus Play with Paramount Plus. Could this be something that Disney does as well?
I think they would be smart too, because I believe in bundling, but I also know that there's a very strong arrogance at Disney to do things on their own. So I'm not sure how that would mix.
I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, I'm not saying they're going to do it, but I wouldn't be surprised if we start seeing, you know, we wake up as we always do, and then there's a big announcement of this happening. I don't know if it's specifically that, but I think we're going to see a lot more announcements of like the, you know, shows from one service on another, or, you know, kind of the cross pollination of content to another service. Or I think we're going to start seeing more and more ways that people can, you know, have access to certain things. I mean, bundling with another service, I don't know, but like bundling with an ISP or a broadband provider to get it for a certain number of months. Yeah, that's just marketing. That's just like putting it in the home and seeing if it sticks. I think we're going to see a lot of very creative offerings in this year in particular.
Yeah, I think Bob Iger said that they were keen to do more telecom bundles. that that was a trend
that makes sense.
One other type of bundle that I've noticed in the marketplace is Walmart's membership program, Walmart Plus, has Paramount Plus. So that type of bundle where you are joining forces with a loyalty, somebody else's loyalty programming to get, and this is for the advertising tier, right? Get you more viewers, get you more eyeballs, get you more revenue with very little, you know, stress on your internal systems. It's just an extension, another distribution agreement. This could, I mean, are we expecting to see more of that this year as well? Yeah.
I think it's a great business model, and I'm sure it works well for Walmart. I just don't know. The answer would be yes, but who?
Who? That's right. We're kind of running out. And talking of running out, we have just about run out of time. So this has been a great discussion. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Matthew, Bill, Josh, Michelle, and Chris. A great discussion. And Eric, we're going to hand it back to you.
Hey, thanks so much, Colin, Michelle, Josh, Matthew, Bill, Chris, for that insightful and invigorating deep dive down the rabbit hole of our crazy industry. It's fascinating. I think maybe I'm going to have to work on a YouTube app an app for subscription sharing, since everybody I don't live in a dorm or have an apartment with six people in it, but I might be able to come up with an app where we could all share our subscriptions across our neighborhood or across the country. Fascinating stuff. So thanks again. Just want to let everybody know we'll be back again with the next episode of The Buzz on March 13th. You can register to attend this and future episodes from our website at ottx.org. And find our podcast on Spotify. I hope you'll join us and invite your friends and colleagues as well to get in on the buzz. OTTX is proud to offer these sessions free to the OTT industry on behalf of our membership. If you're not yet a member, I want to invite you to head out to the OTTX website and look into becoming one. We've got membership tiers for a broad range of organizations and professionals. We'll get the link into the chat in just a second. And with that, I want to thank everybody once again, and happy streaming, everybody.
Thank you, guys.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Thanks. Thanks, everyone.